Howard served as a Marine in World War II. He was a corporal from 1943 to 45, and he was also a sergeant in the reserves from 1948 to 1952. He served in Iwo Jima, Saipan, and Tinpenny.
Tinian.
So were you drafted or did you enlist?
I enlisted. Okay.
Do you know where you were, do you remember where you were living at the time?
I was living in Middlebury, Connecticut.
Middlebury, Connecticut. Why did you join?
Why did I join? Well, I think I saw the marine blue uniform. I think that's what got me.
Yeah.
My dad ran a parking lot behind the post office in Waterbury, and the recruiting officer used to park there, and he'd bring one of them home every so often for dinner, something like that. So I just like the Marines.
Got interested in it. Okay. Can you tell me about your boot camp or your training experiences?
Well, I left for Paris Island, I think it was. Maybe around January, first week in January. And I left from Springfield, Massachusetts. And there was a train up there that was going to pick up Marines on the way down the coast. And we stopped in, I think, Washington, D.C., two or three places going down, picking up ones that were enlisting in the Marine Corps. And we got down to Yamasee, which at that time was where they dropped you off the train. And you waited for what we call cattle cars, they were cattle trucks. And they'd take a whole group of maybe 50 Marines on a truck and take you into Paris Island. And as soon as you went in there, you knew you belonged to the Corps, because everything was just so hop to and everything. And we got in there and we, place where they issued the uniforms. And that was just utilities. Well, it was the whole uniform. And your canteens and so forth and so on. Your boots. And, I don't know if we got our rifle that day or not. And then they went to the barracks. And they were wooden barracks at that time. Since I got out, I went back to visit down there twice. And it's just like being on a college campus now. Mm-hmm. I mean, brick buildings and everything.
Yeah.
And they started indoctrinating you into the Marine Corps as soon as you were there. And then I think we got our shots, some of the shots the next morning. And we went through our preliminary training at Paris Island, and we went out to the rifle range where you fired the, at that time, the M1 Garand rifle, and by the time you got to where you were on the rifle range, you thought that you were a big wig because you were firing on the range, and you got a little cocky. And our drill instructor, of course, the barracks out there were worse than the ones on the main base. He walked in from the NCO room and nobody hollered attention. And he says, "You guys think you're Marines already?" He says, "Take out your toothbrushes and you can sweep the floor."
Wow.
So we learned that. And that was the one thing about the Marines, you say, that their indoctrination was very different from civilian life. And the reason for it was that they wanted you to be a good Marine. Anyway, after we got through boots, we were sent to different places, and I was sent to Camp Lejeune, and I was designated to the engineers, 20th Engineers, and we went through more training there at Parris Island and so forth, Camp Lejeune, and then I think it was around June of 43, we left for Camp Pendleton. Camp Pendleton was was a fairly new camp, Marine camp in California, and we rode the train, I think for 2 or 3 days going across country. And the one thing I remember about it will stay in my mind is they pulled into Yuma, Arizona, and it must have been about 100 degrees or more, and they took us all off the train and had us double time around the town, and boy, it was wicked hot. Mm-hmm. So I'll never forget Yuma, Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
Then we finally came into Pendleton. Pendleton had the wooden barracks, and they were fairly new, and we did more training there, and a lot of field training, as to forging rivers and stuff like that, and some of the guys became bulldozers or operators and stuff like that. And we also had a preliminary landing at, I think it was Onslow Beach, and I think we had another one at San Clemente. And the division left for Marshall Islands, I would say around the 1st of January, somewhere in between. But I did not go out with the division because there was a certain number of us that they kept, and we went directly to Maui and set up the tents and stuff like that for the guys when they came back. And the people in Maui, they were very, very friendly to the Marines. They had an army group there, and they didn't care for the army. But the Marines, and when we come back from operations, they'd meet us at the dock coming off the ship, and they'd be carrying a big sign, Maui's Own Marine 4th Division. And we used to go into Liberty, in Pai, Waluke, Kahului. And then the one place that I enjoyed most of them was the Makawa Steakhouse. And I was talking to a party just about a week ago, and we got talking about Maui, Hawaii, and she was telling me her sister's been out in Maui for 30 years and really enjoys it. Well, anyway, we did our training and so forth and so on. We boarded ship sometime in I'd say the latter part of May. Then we went aboard ship, and from there we went over to up ammunition and stuff, and food supplies. And then we took off from there, and we hit Saipan the 15th of June, 1944. And I was with a group, four of us. There was Sergeant Conway, Corporal Worth, Corporal Guzden, and myself. And somewhere we got messed up and we worked with our own outfit. Well, anyway, we went in on the Amtrak. And Sergeant and myself rolled over the side. We crawled up on the beach, and we were partially in the beach, or the water, and partially on the beach. And this shell come over. My sergeant, who was maybe 3-4 feet from me, hollers, "Whit," he says, "I'm hit." And I says, "How in the hell could you be hit?" And I didn't get hit. So anyway, I went over, and the back of his leg was sliced white open. I don't know what it was, whether it was artillery or mortar. Mm-hmm. And I called for a corpsman, and I dragged him up off to the beach. And I left him. And the first night I dug in to try to dig a foxhole for myself. And here in the Marine Corps, every other man had an entrenching tool or a machete. And I ended up with a machete. So trying to dig a foxhole with a machete was a little difficult, but I got a hole where I could squat in it. My dad had sent me a Colt 45 that he had World War I, and I took that and the bandolier off and set it up on the parapet of the foxhole that I had dug. And I had my rifle, I had a bayonet in it, and the rifle between my legs, standing up so if a Jap came in. So about midnight they started hollering, "Banzai, Banzai, Marine, tonight you die," and they kept this up. They never got to where I was, but thank God. Mm-hmm. So the next morning, I got up and I went looking for my company, and I found that it was about 100 yards down the beach from where I landed. And that morning, one of our lieutenants just got up out of a foxhole. Jap sniper picked him off. He was the first casualty we had. Mm-hmm. And being in the engineers, there, most of our work was working with bulldozers and stuff like that. Throwing satchel charges into pillboxes and stuff. And the things that I remember when we were moving up to Chow Chow Village, and we were out of water. And over there, the people in the houses used to take their water off the roof, and put it rain right off the roof into a cistern. So I saw this house with the cistern there, so I walked over and put my tin cup under the water where the spigot was, and I took a couple of gulps. Then dawned on me, why didn't you look into the cistern before you drank anything? So I looked into the cistern, and it was full of dead birds and everything else. Mm-hmm. So I used to go on a night patrols. I remember we had a Captain Valley. As soon as he'd hear a shot, he'd dive into a ditch. Well, anyway, I came down with, what do you call it, dengue fever or something, I don't know. And I guess I related to the drinking the water there. Mm-hmm. And the one night we went out, from 12 to 2 in the morning, and I was feeling lousy. I had a temperature and everything. But I went out, and besides having the fever, I then come down with dysentery. So between the two of them, I had a lot of fun. So I spent a couple of days in the field hospital there. The one thing that stands out in my mind, other than the fighting, is when we got up near Merripee Point, and we were going into the caves to make sure that the Japs were out of the caves and to see if there was anything in there. So I went into this one cave, and when I was going through it, I thought I heard a baby crying. So I kept looking and looking, and I finally found this little baby. It was on one of these straw things that they use, the chaff, the rice. They take the rice and they throw it in there. Mm-hmm. And little baby was there, so I picked it up. And we had a truckload of prisoners. I mean, there was Shimoro women, Japanese women. And I went out with the baby and threw hand motions to the women to take the baby. Mm-hmm. None of them would take the baby. Mm-hmm. So there was an old Shimoro man, and I can picture it if it was today. He stood there and he had one of these pointed hats on that they wore. Mm-hmm. He had a white goatee, and he comes up to me and taps me and points to the baby and points to himself. So I gave him the baby. And I often wonder whatever happened to him, but mm-hmm. then I think we left Saipan and we hit Tinian. I don't know the dates, but it's on that thing there. Mm-hmm. And Tinian was one of the narrowest beachheads that any division ever landed on. It was only 40 or 50 yards wide. Mm. But we didn't have that much, they didn't put that much of a, resistance. I mean, there was not much resistance. Anyway, we landed on, they thought we were going to land at Tinian Town, and we landed up on the I don't know what side of the island was, but it was a very narrow beachhead. And one of the fellows in the engineers, he was a, what they call a cherry picker, operated a cherry picker. And what that was used for was unloading the ducks when they come in, or any of the vehicles that could not go in, and the cherry picker taking a load of the ammunition stuff out of it. So they put him, he landed on this little barge. They dropped him off on this barge, and I guess he thought that he could take the little cherry picker and drive it off and land it. But when he did, back to it. He tried getting on to the cat, and the tracks caught his dungarees, just ground them up, I mean.
Wow.
And, well, after Tinian, we went aboard ship and then back to Maui. More training and stuff, enjoying the island. There used to be a group of mother and father, and I think there were three daughters, that used to come to entertain us by singing island songs and dancing. And then we had one of the USO group came in. I forget who I think the girl was. But as I say, we then did training and preparing for Iwo Jima. And we went aboard ship. I don't remember the dates are on that, what do you call it, I don't. But I can see. We can get there February the 19th. I would say it must have been sometime in early January that we left, and we went over to Oahu and got provisions and stuff, and loaded a motor ship and so forth. And aboard ship going to Hilo, at first we were supposed to hit Formosa, but they changed and decided to hit Iwo Jima. Well, Iwo Jima had been hit by aerial bombardment, I don't know how many weeks, and heavy naval gunfire, and they figured that be a cakewalk, but we found out that with all the shelling they did from the ships and the aerial bombardment that they inflicted 1% casualties. And when we hit the island, well, I come in on the right flank, furthest point on the right flank, and I remember getting off the vehicle that brought us in, and there was two parapets we had to get up over, and the first thing I remember seeing, and there was a young dead Marine facing just as though he laid down there with his rifle out from. And the shelling was terrific. I mean, you could hardly get up over the parapets because the volcanic ash was so soft that you take one step forward and you have a half a step backwards.
Wow.
And we finally got up on the second parapet. And I spent the first night laying up against the back of a pillbox and then knocked out. And I think it was the second morning or third morning that we were just getting ready to move out, and they started dropping mortars in. And I don't know if there was any heavy artillery in it, I don't remember. But I know there were mortar shells coming in. And two of the fellows that were in my squad were maybe 10 yards from me in the shovel, and I heard them holler, Corman, so I hollered back at him. I said, wait till the third round lands and I'll come over and see what I can do for you. Because under normal conditions, the Japs would fire three rounds and that would be it. They'd pull the weapon back and then reload.
Yeah.
So I got with him maybe, well, I know the one fellow had partial, part of his head that was blown off. And that's the last I remember. I woke up, I was on a board ship. How I got there, I don't know. Well, anyway, I stayed aboard ship. Fourth day, I wanted to come back, so I saw this Navy coxswain. And they're the ones that drive the Higgins boats or however you want to call them in. So I asked him, I said, are you going to be going in tomorrow morning? He said, yes. Well, I said, I'm going to ask you a favor. I says, can you get me a pair of dungarees and a black turtleneck, maybe sweater? Because they take all your clothing away from you, I mean. So I didn't think anything of it. And later that afternoon, he came up and he had a pair of dungarees and a black turtleneck sweater. And dungarees came up about here on me. But so I said to him, I said, are you going in the morning? He says, yeah, I'll be going in about 9 o'clock. So I said, how about taking and getting a ride in with you? He says, okay. So I met him. He told me what David he was going off of, and I met him. I went in and found my company, reported to my lieutenant. Whitaker report for duty, sir. And he looks at me, he says, where's your release? And I looked at him with a dumb smile on my face, because I didn't know what he was talking about. He says, you didn't get a release from the doctor? I said, no. He says, you know, he said, you're the stupidest goddamn Marine I ever saw. So with that, stayed to the end of the operation. I don't remember anything that took place from the time I got back on the island to the night we left, and I think it was Easter Eve that we went aboard transport us back to Maui. And it was the best meal I ever had. The Navy had steak and eggs on for us and everything. The one thing that I didn't mention, one of the most cumbersome and dangerous things was when you went over the side of the ship, you had to go down this rope ladder. And of course, the small boat is down there, and there's waves 20 foot high, so that boat's coming up. You're going down, that boat's coming up. Okay. So, being a corporal, I was the first one to go down the rope ladder, and so that you could hold it tight and away from the boat, because some of the fellas got squashed in between the transport and the small Higgins boats because of the ladders being not taut, being loose. Mm-hmm. And that was one of the most thrilling things, I would say, going over the side of the railing and going down there with a pack on and your rifle and everything. Mm-hmm. But, well, we came back to Maui, and we must have been back to 2 or 3 months. I got called out to my officer's tent. I walked in and recognized the Corporal Whitaker reporting, sir. So he says, Whitaker, he says, I want you to take an exam for officer, or V-12. And I'm saying to myself, Jesus, 3-4 months ago you told me I was the stupidest Marine or what. Now you want me to take the exam for V-12? Well, when he said V-12, I said to him, I said, I don't know what you're talking about. I said, I don't know what V-12 is. Well, he says, if you take it and you pass, you'll go back to States and you'll get 4 years of college then you'll have to do 5 years in the Corps. So I said to him, I says, you've got fellows in here that have had 1 or 2 years of college. I says, why not give them a chance to finish it out? He says, I want you to go. So I was only an average student in high school. I was no whiz. The only thing I really liked in high school was history. So I took the exam and didn't think anything of it. And it must have been 2 or 3 months later, I get called down to the tent. I walk in and pop to him. He says, well, how'd you like to go back to the States? I said, sir, do I have to walk or swim? He says, you passed the exam for V-12. So there was another fellow in there. Let's see, he was, wasn't in my company, but he was in the battalion that passed it. So the two of us hung around till a boat came in to take us over to the island of Oahu, Pearl Harbor. Well, the two of us went over to Pearl Harbor Transit Center, and we had to wait for transport back to the States. Of course, in them days, they didn't have planes flying anywhere back and forth. You had to wait till a boat came in, so we waited there quite a while. Anyway, we got pulled into San Francisco. The day after VJ Day. And I said to my buddy, I said, well, go get into the barracks. I says, we'll take a shower, cleaned up, put our uniform on, and we'll go into San Francisco to get a couple of beers together. But as we got our uniforms on, it's over the loudspeaker, all military, or all Marines restricted to barracks. So that meant we couldn't go in. So anyway, the Navy had torn San Francisco up something terrible. They broke every glass window there was in the city, I think. Mm-hmm. And it was a wreck. So we finally got in there. I think we had to wait 2 days to get in there. And we hung around there for, well, maybe 5 or 6 days for a train to take us back to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. So finally a train came in and we boarded it. We headed back to North Carolina. And got back to Camp Lejeune. They put us up in officers' quarters. So the first morning when I came down for breakfast, there was a Captain Gibson. And he says, Whitaker, he says, how do you like this setup? I said, sir, I've just come from hell and I'm now in heaven. Mm-hmm. There was a table set up for 6 fellas to sit at. Somebody waiting on you, homemade pie, everything you want. Well, anyway, we stayed there for a few days, and they finally called us down individually and told us that the V-12 program had been canceled because of the war being over. But he wanted to know if I would think about going OCS, and that's Officer Candidate School. I said, yes, I said I would. And I says, but there's one thing I'd like to get. I said, I'd like to get at least a 72-hour pass before I have to do anything. He said, you'll get a 72-hour pass when you get through OCS. Well, I says, I'm sorry, sir. I says, I'll take my discharge. So I took my discharge. And that was September something that's on that nice length or 20th, I don't know. There's one thing I do want to say, and I didn't say. The Battle of Iwo Jima was probably the bloodiest battle of all the battles the Marines had been in up until that time. If, now this was said to me by General Krulik, who was, I was at a time when he got up and spoke about Iwo Jima. And he said if they could have taken all the wounded and all the killed and put them head to toe on that island, that they would cover that whole island.
Wow.
I think we lost somewhere in the neighborhood of 26,000 men killed and wounded. And we saved over 26,000 airmen that had been lost at sea. The B-29s that were bombing Tokyo all the time. See, that was the reason for hitting it. Iwo was 750 miles from Hawaii. And it was 750 miles from Tokyo.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, am I wrong, 750 miles from Saipan and Tinian.
Okay.
So the Japanese fighter planes would pick them up heading for Tokyo.
Mm-hmm.
And then go in to see how many they could knock down. And then they would notify Tokyo, and they have fighter planes up to meet them coming in. So by taking Iwo, we saved over 26,000 airmen. So one thing washed the other hand, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And I was on a, the wife and I took a cruise up through some of the islands, and they had a, I forgot what that one goes there.
You said you took a cruise with your wife to the island?
Yeah. We went to Saipan, and I received that thing up on top there, dedication, thanks for serving in, on Saipan and so forth. And I don't know what train of thought is going now. But the first time we went back to Saipan, the company I was working for had sent me out to the Far East. And we were stationed in Taiwan. So we took one trip coming back home. We stopped at Saipan. And at that time, all they had was one little, what they call the Tonga Hotel. It was just about 6-7 rooms. And there was only one Western couple there.
Mm-hmm.
And when we went back on the cruise, which was in, I think, 2000,
mm-hmm.
Saipan is just like Oahu.
Mm-hmm.
Big hotels all over the place.
Oh, wow. So it changed a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. But then I joined the reserves in 1948 because Truman, MacArthur, and some other Army General, Eisenhower, wanted to do away with the Marine Corps because they figured the Marine Corps got too much credit. So anyway, the recruiter came to the house, and the wife was pregnant with our first daughter. And I said I'd sign up for the inactive reserves, which I did. And I told the wife, I said, I'll never recall. I said, I got the regulars, I got the active reserve, and then the inactive. So I got called back for that. I didn't have to go over overseas to Korea. I was very fortunate. That picture of that tank transporter, there was two of them in Korea and they had one in the United States. And they were for picking up disabled tanks. And of course, when you could use them on a beach for hauling them in onto the beach and then up onto the tank transporter. And the wife came down and I told her not to come down, but she came down and she found a rent out in, oh God. It was 36 miles from the base, I know that. And you can look up the roof and you can see the rafters when they come down, you can see the moon shining in. They had no inside privies, no running water. And the wife, our daughter was 2, and our son celebrated his first birthday going through the Marine Corps. Main gate at Camp Lejeune. But the people we rented from were very, very nice, took very good care of the wife when I was on the base, and whenever I had to stay on the base.
How did you keep in contact with your family while you were away? Did you write letters or anything?
They call them days. What did they call them letters, hon? The letters. It wasn't email. What the hell was it?
Oh, was it like a telegraph?
Lil? They were, I can remember, they were on a blue paper, mm-hmm. and you folded it up, and it had a gummed area where you would wet it and seal it. Mm-hmm. But I never wrote much home to my parents. Like that. Mm-hmm. What was the name of them letters that we used to send when I was in the service?
Email.
No,
V-mail.
V-mail. But I never did much writing. And actually, the first thing I got when I was on Iwo, I got this envelope, and I couldn't imagine what it was. And it was my girlfriend, who was now my wife's, picture.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So all the guys looked at me and said, "Who's that chick?" I got out of the Corps in 45. Mm-hmm. It's on that kind of thing. Let's see. No, I joined in 48. I got out in 52.
Oh.
52. So that was my end of a actual Marine activity. I have belonged to the Marine Corps League, the Iwo Jima Survivors Association, the 4th Marine Division Association. I belong to the Veterans of Foreign Wars, the American Legion, so I don't think I've missed too many of them. And actually, I basically would say I came from a military family, because my great-great-great-grandfather died in the Civil War in a prisoner of war camp in Wilmington, North Carolina. I have the letters that he wrote home to his wife. He didn't have to go in. He was a man 37 years old. And he had a daughter 13, and 1 9, and 1 7, I think. But he enlisted in the Pennsylvania Volunteers. And the letters that he wrote home, he knew he was never going to come home. By the way, so I have the letter of his passing on from the commanding officer there.
Mm-hmm.
And then World War One. Someone was in before World War One. What the hell? I don't know what war it was. But my dad, it was an oddity. I ended up in the 4th Marine Division and he was in the 4th Cavalry. And he was stationed in Brownsville, Texas, right on the border. But there's been no, my grandchildren, one of them in the service. So I guess that's the end of my story.
Do you want to add anything about maybe how like the military influenced your thoughts about war?
Well, I say there's a time of peace and a time of war. And I believe in defending your country. And I mean, if I was capable to do it, I'd do it today if I had to. It's just the way I am. I mean, we're in a war now that, I guess I'm going to be wrong in saying this, but president, new president comes in there and it's about terrorism no more. I don't know what the hell he calls it. And, I mean, war is hell. There's no one way about it. It's hell. And it's too bad that there has to be wars. But if you want your country and you're dedicated to your country, you'll fight for your country. And the one thing I say today, and I may be wrong, because my grandkids have graduated from college, but the amount of American history they get today, I don't think amounts enough to fill a thimble. I mean, when I went to school, if you didn't pass American history in your senior year, you didn't graduate. And I was fortunate enough to have a teacher that was my mother's teacher.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
You know, as I say, war is nothing to be proud of, but it has to be done. And there has to be somebody to do it.
That's true.
And I mean, I feel the one Marine incident that happened, that I blame a president that I voted for, and that was the Marine barracks in Beirut, where they got 246 of them killed in the barracks. But something will happen, I guess. I mean, the things today, I mean, I don't know if I could ever do the things that the kids do today. I mean, the weight that they carry with them, and being in these countries that, with the extreme heat and so forth and so on, I mean, my hat's off to them. And the old saying goes, once a Marine, always a Marine. As I say, Semper Fi. I'm going to have that put on my headstone. You know what that means? Always faithful. So.
That's nice.
Do you have any other questions?
Is there anything that you would like to add? Maybe how your service and experiences affected your life?
Well, the only thing I can say about my life, I mean, got out of the service. I had no background in anything because what I wanted to be, I went to Wilby High School, which was a high school where they taught you shorthand, or is that what they call it, I guess. And I wanted to be a sports writer. That was my ambition. But it never happened, so I went to work for one company in Naugatuck, and I left that company to go to another company for a penny more an hour. And I told my son that, and he said, "Dad, you got to be nuts." I said, "Jim, in them days, 7 cents bought a loaf of bread." And so I stayed with Lux Clark. I was transferred to Tennessee and took the family down there. My daughter graduated from high school down there. My son went to a military school down there. Mm-hmm. And the Vietnam War broke out. And I had lived in Middlebury most of my life. Mm-hmm. And I was a constable and a volunteer fireman on the Board of Education. Anyway, I came back on vacation from Tennessee, and this buddy of mine that was a constable, he says, Whitty, says, you know, he says, Timex is going to be making fuses for the Vietnam War, and they're looking for management people. And I said, well, I says, Harold, I'm satisfied down in Tennessee. I said, it's a different way of life down there, very much laid back. Mm-hmm. And I said, but the only thing, that if I had stayed there, I had to wait till I broke a man in my capacity before I got a raise. So this Pat McFadden called me, Timex, and I went and he interviewed me, and he said, make an offer, Howard. He made an offer. I couldn't refuse the offer. Mm-hmm. So I went back and told him, gentleman that I was reporting to, and he was a PT boat sailor officer, and he was a very good friend of Jack Kennedy, who was a PT boat man. Mm-hmm. He was in the same squadron. Well, and me being a Marine, a former Marine, he thought I was just what the doctor ordered, so mm-hmm. we got along well together. Well, anyway, I told him, I said, I'll give you 2 weeks, Joe, and then I got to go back up there. I said, I told him. So 2 weeks coming, it wasn't over, so he called me and he says, Howard, I'd like you to stay another week if you would. I says, Joe, I said, I promised them 2 weeks and they're starting up production. So I finally called McFadden and he says, all right, he said, I'll give you another week and that's it. So I had a phone broke in, but he was fair. I hired the first 5 black women in the state of Tennessee to work.
Wow.
And I took 5 of them, I brought them in my office, and I told them. I says, color means nothing to me. I says, I'll expect the same thing out of you as I would out of 5 white people.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't, you won't be here.
Mm-hmm.
So 3 of them made it and 2 of them didn't.
Mm-hmm.
But I was the first one that had black people working. Because the regular Southerners, they wouldn't have.
Mm-hmm.
Well, as I say, then I went to Timex. They bought this, or rented this place up in Oakville. And we set everything up. I set the first 500 fuses that we sent to Aberdeen training grounds, and they went through 100%. There wasn't one defect.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I'd go blind doing it, but I did it. And then I ended up, I had the whole second floor with all the secondary operations of the fuses. And I had a lot of Portuguese women. And Italian women. Probably the best workers I had were the Portuguese women.
Mm-hmm.
They were very, very good workers.
Mm-hmm.
Never complained, did their job. And every time they went back to Portugal for vacation, they'd bring me back a bottle of brandy.
Mm-hmm.
I still have one of the bottles, and that's...
Wow.
That was 19. Looks like 67.
Uh-huh.
Well, anyway, I stayed down all the sub-assembly, and then they were getting so many defects. My big boss called me down and he says, Howard, he says, I want you to take over the first floor too. That was where they assembled all the small parts that I made upstairs. They put them together into a fuse.
Mm-hmm.
And a fuse was something like a watch. You said it. And so I ended up, I had the whole thing. And I had supposedly the first shift, but I didn't know how many nights I got called. I'd be down there at 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. I'd be down there at 11 o'clock at night. But anyway, we put out the, got things squared away, and we put out this fuse product that the government got. Of course, Timex was getting the top dollar for it, too. And then that was going out. And they got called down to the main office, and they said, Howard, we're sending a plant in Taiwan. And we'd like to know if you want to go out there, head up the manufacturing part of it. So I talked to them with the wife and the kids. At that time, my daughter had graduated from college, or school, college, yeah. And my son was, this last year. So he said, yeah, that's better for you. You're going to be making better money. So we took that. We flew. At that time, you had to fly from JFK to Alaska, and then Alaska to Japan, Japan to Taiwan. We spent almost 24 hours in the air.
Wow.
And getting there now, you're going 14 hours. They allowed us two suitcases apiece. And I said to McFadden, I said, Pat, I said, the fella as tall as I am, how the hell am I going to get any clothes over there? Well, he says, you can take enough in your suitcase. Well, anyway, we went over to Hong Kong where we had a long weekend. And they had tailors over there that made me a beautiful suit for $35,
wow.
Made me a pair of shoes. So, panned out. And, that was a great experience. I mean, I came back, and then they sent me back for 2 years more because the guy that took the place was a young fellow. And I told the fellow that was the boss there, I said, you get a young fellow in here, I says, and all them loose chaussees around, I says, he's not going to worry about the plant. They had some damn many repairs. Fill this house with them. So I go back and to 2 years more. And then I come back and they call me again to go over to the Philippines. The plant over there was having problems. So I went to the Philippines, the wife and I, because I would never go anyplace without her. I seen too many guys go over that were married and end up being divorced. So Filipino are nice. The Filipino people are nice people. And I did three times. I went back for 3 months. And then finally I come back and they sent me down to Little Rock, Arkansas, because they were having problems with defects and so forth. Spent some time down there and squared away, and then I come back and they had a distribution center in Torrington, and they had a college fellow running it, didn't know his butt from a hole in the ground. I wonder why some of these kids go to college. I mean it. You're running an operation of watches, and they didn't have any inventory set up. And they were losing on average 100 watches a day.
Mm-hmm.
And come to find out it was a night watchman. He'd take them watches down the ark and sell them for $10 a piece.
Oh my God.
It was making himself a fortune.
Yeah.
So
Jeez. They
put me in up there as soon as I went in. I set up an inventory so we knew how many were made out on the line, how many went into the into the room where they issue them out to be cased and so forth. And they found out who was taking them. And this, her name was Miss Fred Guinness. And she now is a probate judge, I think, up in Litchfield. She was district attorney, I think, at that time. And she came in and she says, Mr. Whitaker, she says, we know who done it. there's nothing we can do about it because you have no records of how many watches you had.
Wow.
So he got away with it.
Jeez.
So that ended it up. Well, he was about finished.
Yeah, so, yeah,
okay.
We're out of time. Yeah.
It's all up?
Yeah.
Good.